Preoperative dilatation and curettage is an integral part of Pothgill surgery. After adequate dilatation, the endometrium is thoroughly curated. Thereafter, the length of the uterus is noted. This is called a uterocervical length. It is the distance from the fundus to the external cervical os. In this case, it is around 12 cm and you have decided to remove around 5 cm of supravaginal cervix. The procedure begins with adrenaline infiltration. For this, we take dilute adrenaline, one ampoule diluted in 200 ml of saline. The actual incision should join all the follicle points. In this case, with experience, I have not marked the follicle points. Anyway, for the benefit of viewers, there are totally 4 follicle points. The upper follicle points is between the around 3 to 4 cm beneath the external urethra, 2 at the lateral fornices and 1 at the posterior fornix. The posterior vagina is gradually separated using the sharp scissor. We can see the uterosacral standing out there. The lateral vagina on the lateral aspect is gradually separated using the sharp dissection. Because of the adrenal infiltration, we can note that the bleeding is kept minimal. The balsam is applied to the anterior cervix and a good traction is given, and the upper vaginal apex is mobilized around 2 cm from the incision line. The V-shaped anterior vagina is pulled down. In this case, you can see I am using the curve of the artery forceps to pull the vagina flap down. That allows the tearing of the vagina. Posteriorly, the dissection is carried up to the pouch of Douglas. If there is a significant cystocele or the rectocele, this has to be simultaneously corrected while doing follicle surgery. Now you can see the pubovesicocervical ligament has been transected using the cautery knife using the cut current. Then the bladder is pushed high up till you see the vesicle fat that demarcates the upper extent of dissection. You can see here, using the long hysterectomy clamp, both the Meckenrot ligament and the uterosacral ligaments are held together, they are clamped together, they are cut, and thereafter they are ligated. When I am ligating, make sure that you are taking number 1 Vicryl and you are placing the transfixation stitches in order to avoid slipping of the ligature. So after placing the ligature, you keep a long length of the Vicryl on the non-needle side to identify the ligament for the later purpose. Similarly, the procedure is carried out on the right side. Both the complexes are held with a pair of long hysterectomy clamps, straight hysterectomy clamps, and using the cutting current, the ligament is transected. Again, remember, the tip of the clamp should be below the level of the internal os. Carrying it very high up sometimes include the uterine artery, and that compromises the blood supply to the uterus. So remember, you are supposed to hold only the ligamentous part and not the ascending branch of the uterine artery. So on the right side, the ligament complex is clamped, cut and ligated, and the suture is held long. So this exposes the elongated cervix completely. and you can decide how much of the service should be removed. In one of the previous cases, we experienced cervical stump bleeding in the postoperative period requiring re-exploration, and we have made it a point to ligate the descending cervical artery on either side. And again, remember, the artery is not very clearly seen as a separate branch, so we have to take a bite through the cervix at 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock position, and you have to put a tight ligature, hoping that the ligature includes the descending cervical artery. This also minimizes the bleeding from the cervical stump. Using the cutting current, the cervical amputation is done. Remember that you are supposed to leave behind around 2.5 cm of the functioning cervical canal. In this case, you have nearly removed 5 cm of elongated cervix. Remember, the cervical canal should be loose and should be adequately dilated, because while performing sturm drop suture, the vagina is like supposed to be pulled inside the cervical canal. This case had a mild enterocele, and while dissecting, the enterocele sac got opened up. So you can see here, we are separating the enterocele sac. If the patient wants tubectomy at the same time, tubectomy also can be done through this opening. Anyway, this patient was not keen on sterilization. Remember, the high fertilization of the enterocele sac helps in avoiding the future recurrences. This case, we decided to do sacrospinous fixation of the posterior vagina. So using 3 Devers retractor, after approaching the lateral vaginal wall beneath the ligament complexes, we placed 2 sutures to the sacrospinous ligament. This part of the video explains how to take the Fothergill stitches. The ligature has to pass through the left ligated Meckenrod uterosacral complex, should go through the anterior surface of the cervix, and the needle should pass through the opposite uterosacral Meckenrod complex. Then they are tied together in the midline using tension. Many times you notice that the thread works out loose, and it is better to step the knot. Classical textbook description says that one throw of ligature is good enough, but if you have got a wide Meckenrod uterosacral complex, you can do it at multiple levels. So you can see here, the Fothergill stitch is again repeated in the same way at different levels. So the right stitch, it passes through the cut transverse ligament, then through the anterior cervix, and through the right side ligament complex. So you can see here, the needle is passing through the anterior cervix above the previous puncture. So that means that you are bringing a good amount of this Meckenrod ligament anterior to the cervix. The advantage of doing this procedure is that the cervix falls backwards in the pelvis, the fundus falls forward, and that causes almost a good antiversion of the uterus, and this gives positional support to the uterus. So during the act of cough, the uterus, instead of straight away descending down, it becomes flat, and because the uterus measures 7.5 cm, when it is in a horizontal position, usually the pelvic hiatus easily hold on to the uterus. It does not allow the uterus to descend in the vagina like a piston in the syringe. So in this case, you have done a good anterior ligation of the ligaments, so that a good rim of the condensed paracervical tissues are available anterior to the cervix, resulting in not only anteversion of the uterus and also the cervix is naturally pulled upwards. This part of the video explains what is called as termed off sutures. Basically it is for creation of the new vaginal lips. The posterior vagina is ligated in the center at 6 o'clock position using a long number 1 Vicryl in the center. Then the needle passes through the cervical canal and it is brought out at 5 o'clock position in the posterior vagina. The same step is repeated on the other side. The needle passes through the cervical canal and it comes out 7 o'clock. If you have a double-sided needle Vicryl, then the procedure is slightly easy. Otherwise you have to take a separate Mayo's needle and you have to thread the free end of the Vicryl and you have to pull it through the cervical canal. Tell your assistant to hold the posterior vagina at 6 o'clock position and to guide it inside the cervical canal, and the thread is pulled as much as down as possible in order to cause firm opposition of vaginal flaps against the bare cervix. This has twofold advantage. Number one, it prevents the local bleeding and it also causes good covering of the raw cervix, resulting in minimal bleeding in the postoperative period, and it also enhances the healing process. Remember, in a similar fashion, the 9 o'clock and 3 o'clock position of the posterior vagina is drawn inside the cervical canal. Though the test book says that the posterior sternum drops is good enough, and anteriorly and laterally, simply the vagina can be sutured to the bare cervix. If the patient has good amount of redundant vagina, it is better to do a sternum drops both at 3 o'clock and at 9 o'clock position. Using the same principle, pull it down as much as possible so that the vagina is drawn inside the cervical canal. Once both side the procedure is done, next you have to proceed with anterior colporrhaphy. Anterior colporrhaphy can be accomplished either by plicating by series of sutures in the midline, taking bite through the right and left pubo-sacrocervical ligament, or you can also take a simple pursing sutures. In this case, the needle has passed through the paravaginal tissue and through the divaricated pubo-sacrocervical ligament on the left side, and the needle also passes through the anterior cervix and through the right paravaginal tissue, so that the pubo-sacrocervical ligament is reconstructed. The gap between the pubo-sacrocervical ligament is closed off and this sends the bladder high up into the abdomen and thereby preventing recurrence of the cystocele. If the patient has a good amount of the redundant vaginal tissue, the same pursing sutures can be done below the first pursing suture with the same principles. Once the bladder buttressing is done, then you have to close the anterior vagina. The apex of the vagina is closed with number 10 or 20 Vicryl, and the vaginal flaps are approximated to the midline using continuous locking stitches. Remember, there is no need to remove the redundant vaginal tissue in this case because the inverted V-shaped vagina has been already removed in the beginning of the case. It is very important that when you are closing the anterior vagina, the anterior lip of the new cervix should be held with the alice and the vaginal mucosa should be firmly tied to the barrier of the anterior cervix. And make sure that no time the external cervical canal is obstructed. So once the sutures are firmly passed through the vagina and through the cervix, the remaining unsutured portion of the anterior vagina can be closed and the suture can be ended. So remember, whenever there is a fothergill surgery with a vaginal elongation, it is not only the correcting the elongation of the cervix and giving the positional support to the uterus, you are also supposed to do anterior colporrhaphy if there is a cystocele and posterior colporrhaphy if there is a rectocele. Remember that there are two pairs of long strands were passed to the right sacrospinous ligament which are brought out of the vagina. Now it is the time to ligate them and take the ligature as high as possible so that the posterior vaginal fornix is pulled towards the right sacrospinous complex. You can see here we have achieved a good amount of the vaginal depth